Okay, here we are. We're good to go now. All right. Good afternoon, everyone. And thank you all for joining us for today's month of service presentation of disaster readiness and planning ahead. My name is Nia Murray. I am the programs coordinator with Neighborhood Recovery Community Development Corporation, and we are one of the partners in the month of service collaboration. Also included is the City of Houston's Department of Neighborhoods. And joining us today, we have Ms. Rachel Gutierrez. Also, on behalf of our presenting partner with Lone Star Legal Aid, we have Ms. Sophia Ayers and, oh my gosh, and Ms. Amanda Bosley. Also presenting with us, we have United Way Wanda Alex Edwards, who's going to be providing information for you all today about disaster preparedness and disaster readiness. But also included in the partnership, we have the Earl Carle Institute, Houston Bar Association, Harris County. A tax assessor collector's office, Harris Central Appraisal District, the volunteer lawyers, and the Texas Legal Services Center. And together we all make up a month of service. And basically, just to give you guys a little bit of a background, a month of service is the collaboration of all eight of these or nine of these organizations. We come together on a monthly basis and offer a variety of workshops relative to community empowerment, asset building, asset protection, and the maintaining of generational wealth. So we know that there are a lot of underserved communities that are out there and a lot of communities that do not have access to a lot of resources to various information that's available to them. So we decided several years ago to come together and in hopes of creating a larger impact and reaching more people to provide in the end of an emergency or, you know, when they're in need of some type of resource, they'll know where to go, who to ask, and how to access those different resources. So in addition to that, we wanted to, because we were on this virtual platform, sorry, before we were in person giving this information out in various communities, but we've had to try platform throughout. So we want to thank you guys for allowing us that opportunity to continue to provide as much information and get as much resources as we can out to the community that we all do serve. So thank you guys very much for joining us here today. Here's your opportunity to ask whatever questions that it is that you have of you know of our professionals that we have that are experts in their fields. So, however, we do want you to keep in mind that the information that is provided here today by the legal service organization, Lone Star Legal Aid, is not to be considered legal advice. It is for educational purposes only. However, if you do find yourselves in need of some specific legal assistance, then we do encourage you to reach out to the legal service partners. So, also keep in mind that while you're asking your questions that we try to ask that you keep them to be as general as you possibly can and not have any personal detailed information kind of getting out there for everyone to have access to as we are recording the session as well as broadcasting live on our social media platforms. So we want to try to protect your privacy as much as we possibly can. So we are in the midst or in the beginning of the hurricane season. And I see I do have the wrong date that's on this slide here, June the 4th, I believe June 1st is like the beginning of hurricane season. So we are in the midst of hurricane season, but know that disaster readiness and disaster preparedness is not just about hurricane season, that it's about being prepared in the event of any kind of a disaster. We've had these storms over the last several weeks that multiple people have been impacted by. I know that there's been new announcements and things from FEMA that have come out about how to about applying for different services and things like that. So they're going to be going over all of that information for you guys today. And we want to, again, thank you guys for joining us. We want to go ahead and let everybody introduce themselves, and then we will get right on into the presentation. So, Ms. Rachel, why don't we have you go first?
Sorry. Rose there. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rachel Gutierrez. I am a community outreach coordinator for the Department of Neighborhoods Office of Neighborhood Engagement on behalf of Mayor Whitmire and our director, Director Sims. We welcome you to the Month of Service program. We want to thank the partners for this collaboration and for them volunteering their time to provide you with this very vital information that you need for at this time, obviously because of hurricane season, but also just in general, when any natural disaster does occur, you have this information to be able to assist you to get through it. But along with topics like this, we do offer additional topics that will be beneficial to you or to those that you know when they come across some sort of situation that could potentially be life-altering or maybe that they can help with improving their life. So we do encourage you to continue to engage with us and refer those that you encounter on a day-to-day basis, whether it's family, whether it's friends, those in your community, let them know about this information. It's free. It's from professionals, and it's more than likely the accurate information that you need versus the information that you hear from the street. So we do encourage for you to spread the word of this amazing program. There's always different topics that we cover, and if there is a topic that we currently do not cover, feel free to reach out to myself or to Nia. We can definitely work on assisting with obtaining that for you. But once again, we thank you for tuning in today, and thank you to the partners. And I'll let the o window open to them.
Okay. So Sophia and Amanda, why don't you have you guys go first, and then Alex will have you introduce, and then you can get on into your presentation.
Hi, everybody. My name is Sapna Iyer with Lone Star Legal Aid. I'm a direct attorney of the Houston office. And Amanda and I are going to talk to you about disaster preparedness and also what happens after a disaster.
Thank you, Sapna. My name is Amanda Bosley. I'm the managing attorney of the Disaster Relief Unit at Lone Star Legal Aid here in Houston, and I'm happy to be here. Thanks, everybody, for joining.
Okay, Alex.
Hello, everybody. My name is Alex Edwards. I'm the Disaster and Outreach Coordinator here at the 211 United Way Texas Helpline. And today I'll be going over disaster preparedness with 211 and how we interact during times of disaster.
Okay, let's go ahead and get started. You guys are all on mute.
All right, everybody, thank you for having me out today. And so, like I said, we're going to dive into hurricane preparedness with 211. And so what to expect in this presentation, we're going to go over the forecast for the season, both past and present. I think it's important to compare to previous years so we can kind of see about what the trends are, as well as where we're starting versus where we're ending from last season. We're going to go into disaster coordinators, what that looks like, and in terms of what we all do here at 211. And so that way, knowing what to expect, but then also knowing about how to connect regarding in terms of for trainings such as these. And then also the 211's roles during disaster. We're going to dive deeply into personal preparedness for your household, for your family, for your vehicles as well, possibly depending on the situation. We're going to talk about STEER as well as State of Texas Emergency Assistance Registry and 211's connection to that. And then last but not least, self-care reminders, whether it be if you are in a response role or just a person going through a hard time in the midst of a disaster. But before we dive into all of this, just a very quick overview in terms of 211, who we are, what we do. And so 211 is a multi-service line that's here in the state of Texas as well as in the rest of the country, and to where what we do is we help connect community members to local resources close to where they are. We, on option one side of the line, we're open 24/7, 365. And so what we do is, like I said, we help to get those basic resources near you in terms of anything that you may need for basic basic needs and services. And so we have over 150 languages we can get access to and for translation services. And so we also have multiple ways you can get in contact. You can call us, text us, email us, you can chat us. You can also search our database online for those blue sky resources, just those things from day to day. But then also during times of emergency and disaster, we also have those resources too, that you can look up and to be able to see about who's providing what services and where. So, forecast for the region. I don't know if you know this, but last year we did something as a whole species on humanity. We set a record, not exactly the greatest record, but last year was the hottest year in recorded history. And so with that being said, a lot of times I think that some folks may believe or they may think that each hurricane season starts off back at zero. But if last year was the hottest year, we're kind of going to pick up a little bit about where we left off. So this image on the left shows you the average temperatures going from 1976 all the way up to 2023. And this is from the global aspect. The image on the right shows in terms of the record warmest areas from January to December in 2023. And as you can see, when you look in the Gulf Coast region, it's already deep red, which means that we set some records last year. So we are anticipated to being able to have a very, very active season. Now, coming up here, this map is the National Risk Assessment Index map. I think it's a pretty good tool to be able to have in your tool belt. And just in terms of understanding resiliency, as well as the ability to respond to those types of situations, such as disaster. As you can see, blue represents higher levels of resiliency in terms of being able to come back after being impacted by a disaster. This QR code will actually take you directly to the website, so you'll be able to do a little bit more investigation for yourself in terms of understanding about the types of risks and threats that take place. But I think that this is just a good tool to be able to have and understand in terms of your area, the types of hazards that you may face, and being able to plan and prepare accordingly for the types of disasters that you may currently be facing where you are or where you may be going to next as well. So here we are, the forecast for the season is out. We are expecting for this year, 2024, 20 to 25 named storms, 8 to 12 of those becoming hurricanes, and then 4 to 7 major hurricanes. But then we have 4 to 6 having a direct impact to the United States. There has been some talk to saying that there is a possibility that we're having a season that may show some resemblance to 2020, in which we run out of hurricane names. So we are expecting a lot of activity in the Gulf, but this is also important about why we're doing this right now. So then that way we can make sure that we stay on top of staying prepared. So, and these are also the names that you can see right there. Now, in terms of if you want to go and give more information about just in terms of the warmest record, that QR link on the top will take you there. And some of you may have heard, especially during last year, about will there be a Category 6 added to the hurricane scale? The answer to that is no. There are a lot of different things that are considered in terms of, you know, what makes a hurricane, or what makes them, how the rating system works. And so that QR code on the bottom will take you to information about why they're not adding an additional category, but then also just in terms of how the categories in the systems work, which I think is very important to know. So now here we are in terms of January. First, going all the way up to November 30th, being hurricane season. And what we can see here on this is the average amount of storms and per what month. So even though this is the start, we're not usually, you're going to see a lot of activity happening in the Atlantic. But as we start getting towards that sweet spot of September to October, and also so August, September, October, especially between September and October, we're going to possibly see a lot more action going on in the Atlantic, in the Gulf. And so this is why it's important that we start our preparation process now, that we're making sure that we're getting things together. So then that way, when we get towards the heart of the season, we'll be able to be as best prepared for any type of circumstance that we have regarding any type of action coming from the Gulf. So now in terms of disaster coordinators and what we do here at the United Way, and we actually take care of a total of 33 counties. We're the largest call center here in the state of Texas, and we take care of 13 counties, particularly within the Gulf Coast region. And so what we do is we help to represent the United Way and their interests and being able to coordinate with local partners, whether volunteer agencies, county government, regional government, offices of emergency management, to be able to help and to develop those relationships, to be able to identify and find resources so that way we can get them into our database and then have them readily available for community members as you all are looking for those resources as well. So also being involved with the volunteer organizations after disaster, the VOAD meetings, as well as long-term recovery efforts after disasters are done, because we all know that there's the initial emergency, but then afterwards those long-term resources that individuals are looking for, you can also give 211 a call to be able to help find what those additional resources are as we move through the phases of disaster. So being able to understand about what FEMA may be offering, being able to get connected to those Salvation Armies or other type of disaster resources, that's also what we're here to do. As well as we have our own emergency protocols to make sure that our network stays up and running as 211. We are part of a network of other 22 other 211s here in the state of Texas. And so we all work together to serve all of Texas, to making sure that even if one 211 may go offline due to an emergency, the other 211s are still up and active to be able to help and to respond to provide resources and assistance to those in need all across the state of Texas. So in terms of 211's role during disaster, we are that go-to source in terms of finding out those basic needs, whether it's a blue sky day, but also during terms of gray skies. We also have the ability to be able to have our volunteer force come in and to add additional workspaces to be able to help with the large amount of call volume that oftentimes comes with disasters. And so being able to have that on hand is something that we're very prideful of as well. And so last but not least, helping to register people for the State of Texas Emergency Assistance Registry. Now would be the time to register So we just encourage and educate people about that program as well and about what it can do, but also what it cannot do, which we're going to dive into a lot more about that in just a little bit later on. So now let's go ahead and talk about personal preparedness. So the best thing that you can do in order to be prepared about a situation, whether it's anything in life, is to understand your exits. And so with that being said, knowing about where you are supposed to go or and how that's supposed to happen. And so just having that understanding of evacuation zones, routes, how the process takes place, how the process may change over years and time, it is important to understand what's your area and what's your zip zone. So let's say, for instance, if you may have heard that there are evacuations that are taking place, whether they're voluntary or mandatory, in the event of, say, for instance, a hurricane, and you're not sure if your zip code has been one that has been called for, you can give us a call here 211, and we'll be able to take a look to see about which ones are actually being evacuated at that time. We'll have that information. And so as the situations are developing and progressing, we're going to make sure that we're updating our database and information as well. So if the situation changes, you can still give us a call back and we'll still be able to give you that information regarding disaster and evacuation routes, zones, and as well as which zones are being evacuated or which zones have which order for evacuations. And so for our region, this is what we're looking at in terms of 290 and being able to head north, as well as in terms of the lane contraflow plan as well, to where at a certain point, if we are in a full-scale evacuation, those lanes will actually flip direction and they will all be heading 290 north, heading towards Austin. So just understanding about how contraflow works and about the process and pre-planning your route as well in terms of what works best for you and your evacuation process. So now in terms of your bag and your kit, making sure that every person has their bag. So whether it's with the kids or with yourself, and that, you know, making sure that everyone has their own bag with their own types of supplies that are specific towards their needs. So chargers, backpack, you know, flashlight, whistle. A whistle also can be a very important tool, first aid kit, you know, making sure that we have those things is very important. And especially for kids, you know, making sure that we also have a phone number of a loved one who may live outside of the disaster area or the state. Reason being to where if they're ever separated, when responders are able to actually find the child, they're going to go through their supplies. If they find the phone number, they're going to call that number. So then that way you can have a loved one who is on the is kind of a pivot point of information to where if you call them, if your phone is down, you'll be able to relay information about who's located where as a part of your communications plan to be able to find ways to reunite with one another. But just making sure that you have your go bag ready at the beginning of the season is a very important thing to have. And you can be able to find more information at these links. Ready.gov is a great place to start in terms of building your kit, whether it's for to go or to stay. This is something definitely worth checking out if you haven't already done so already. So now just a little bit more information about make a plan and to know your route. To be able to stay informed, have a ways of getting verified information is key. And that's also a part of what 201 comes in as well. So being able to call us to understand what the situation is. And as the situation is developing, we're going to get more information too. So in our information, we make sure that we verify and check it before we put it into our database. So we are a good place to call in terms of that. And especially when looking for those resources, where are the shelters? What is the evacuation route? Understanding what those things look like. That's also information that 211 will have as well. So just being able to make sure they give us a call, text, or you can chat us online as well. So building out your kit, especially if it's a go bag or a stay-at-home kit, these are some of the things that you may want to consider having either in both. So they say making sure to have enough water per person, so 1 gallon. So it lasts about 3 days or possibly a 2-week supply for the entire household. Making sure that you're getting up with your non-perishables if you haven't already done so already. Just getting to a practice of making sure to purchase maybe 2 cans per person each visit off season. So then that way you can continuously build up that supply. Making sure that you have a way to receive information. So whether if it's you, if you're relying on your smartphone, making sure that you have those extra battery banks so that way you can keep things up and going. But also it does not hurt to have that hand crank radio as a backup, because as we know, internet services or cell phone services may be down. And so just having that last line of information to receive that information can be very critical in terms of knowing where the resources are located, where to go, or possibly where to not go, depending on the circumstances at hand. Always, always making sure that we have extra cash, an emergency kit in terms of not just a first aid kit, but possibly even upgrading to a trauma kit, depending on the circumstances to where if emergency services are offline to where they cannot get to you and you do have a medical emergency, the more that you could have in terms of medical supplies to possibly help in that situation, as well as the proper training beforehand, can help for you to be able to prolonged comfort for the individual in need while you are working on a plan to get them to medical professionals, or if your medical professionals are working their way towards you. So just making sure that you get trained as best as you can, get the right supplies, just in case. It's better to have it not needed versus to need it and to not have it. So we are not forgetting about our little furry friends as well. We want to make sure that we have enough food for them as well as enough water for them. So making sure we're including that in the plan as well. So possibly talking to boarding facilities and veterinarians to seeing about if they are being able to be served as designated locations for evacuation. Also in our database, we do check to make sure that we understand about if shelters are accepting pets and also which shelters are accepting pets. This is something that we recently had in our database for the floods that we experienced, and that people were looking for shelter about where could they take their animals, or even if it was a livestock related situation, where could they possibly take their livestock to be able to have to get food and water, or who they could possibly contact for that type of need as well. So just making sure that you also plan for your pets in these emergencies as well. So now staying informed, many different ways. If you have not already downloaded some of these apps, I highly suggest that you do and turn the notifications on, because they are a really good source of being able to get that information in terms of if there's a boil water notice, or if there is a shelter that's set up near you, or if there is an evacuation order, or if there's a straight line wind or a storm that's coming on, that's severe weather. So whether if it's with KHOU News or any type of the news apps, or like I said, readyharris.org is a great app to have, especially if you live in Harris County. Just being able to make sure that you can get those alerts about those emergency situations, whether it's a flash flood warning, whatever it could be, it really helps to be in the know. And it's a great way to stay informed during times of disaster. So now in terms of who to call for what and when, 911, old school style in terms of for those emergencies, whether it's for immediate health crisis or crime. 311 for those non-emergencies, so debris pickup, traffic signals, sign maintenance, those non-emergency situations. 211, for those resources, those local community-based resources for anywhere in the state of Texas, or to register for that STEER program. And so this next thing, we're just going to briefly touch over just in terms of making sure that you do a check-in with your insurance company to see about if your policy has changed, or maybe if there's something that you could possibly add. And just to go over your policy, whether if it's for homeowner or for renters, and just to understand it through and through, because as things change legislatively, some things may change in terms of the types of access that you may have, or the types of policy or your policy itself. So just make sure that you do a check-in with your insurance company just to understand how the policy has either changed or what your policy looks like for this year. So, and if you haven't already done so, making sure that you have flood insurance, understanding what that looks like for yourself. And so that just being able to get more information on that, or as much information on that as you can really, really help you out in the long run. So just making sure that you stay up to information on that as well. So now in terms of FEMA implementing changes, this is the first time in the last 20 years that they've done so, and they did it on March of 2024. This QR code will actually take you to the FEMA website to really be able to read about some of those new updates that they've made recently. I think it's very important just to stay up to date about things that are newly available. And so definitely worth something looking into and checking out. So now we're going to talk about STEER, and what it is and what it does and what it does not do. So as I stated before, the STEER is the State of Texas Emergency Assistance Registry. It's a program that's designed to be able to help the most vulnerable Texans that may need some assistance during times of disaster in terms of check-ins or evacuations if they activate those STEER programs. The STEER program does not guarantee services during an emergency, even though there may be an emergent time that is taking place. And so the STEER is provided by those local emergency planners. So it's usually done by the county or the city in which a person lives in. Out of the 254 counties here in Texas, it's about 110 that are participating in the STEER program. The city of Houston and Harris County are both a part of the STEER program as well. So you can register either online at the STEER website, or you can give us a call here at 211, press option 4, and we can register folks over the phone. So when it comes to the STEER program, it's a way to really help connect people to the possibility of that service. And so registrants, they have to re-register every year. So every year they actually dump the rolls, and the folks need to re-register every January. The reason for that is that way they want to make sure that they have the most up-to-date information about participants, to where some people may move, they may have a change in medical status, and they have new information that they put onto their STEER file or their STEER form. And so every January, make sure that you re-register with the STEER program if you so choose to do so. Now, also when it comes to STEER, it is not confidential any longer, to where a lot of this information, it must be shared amongst either what's transportation services, emergency management, different types of government agencies. And so it is just important to understand that just to be able to make that choice about whether or not an individual would like to register for the STEER program. So now in terms of the STEER program, there is no cutoff in terms of when to register. However, if there is a, say for instance, hurricane that is, you know, hours away from landfall, there may not be a time to where they're actually able to get to the individual because of how soon the event is about to happen and arrive on our doorstep. So the earlier that you register and the earlier that you're able to get into the database, it gets added to the list of individuals about who to do check-ins with first, as well as if they do activate a disaster declaration, as well as an evacuation orders, depending on how your county or city runs their STEER program. If there is an evacuation order and they do evacuations, then they'll start to proceed alongside with that process. So now just a couple pieces of information that they ask for in terms of STEER: name, physical address, they need a phone number as well, and primary language. They're also going to ask for emergency contacts, pets, also track transportation assistance to see about what that looks like, as well as some very surface level medical questions to make sure that they're bringing the right type of transport to the household if they need to do transportation for an evacuation or getting the individual to a secondary location. And so also in terms of wellness checks, this is also one of the things that STEER program is for, to where if an individual or household is without electricity for over 24, electricity, water, or gas for over about 24 hours or so, the participating STEER counties will then, they're mandated by law to then proceed and to do text messages or phone calls out to those on the list to see and to do wellness checks if they are able to be all right in the circumstances that they're currently in. And if they're not able to get back to those individuals or to hear back from them, that's when they start doing the physical checks, just to make sure that folks are doing all right in terms of that event. And if not, being able to help provide them with care and services of, you know, whether it's getting them to the next location or making sure to help provide them with some form of like water or food, depending on the situations. And so in terms of STEER evacuation process, and this is a big if, oftentimes there's not an activation for evacuation, but just having a brief understanding of what that could look like, depending on either if the Office of Emergency Management even does evacuations or what that looks like and can entail. But if there is an instance for evacuation, oftentimes in the past, cities such as San Antonio, Austin, and Dallas have been those evacuation destinations. So it's going to take anywhere between 10 to 20 hours. So make sure that you're planning and prepared for that and having your go bag ready to possibly be able to be on the road for a while. Upon being able to evacuate, if there is a large scale evacuation, there is a wristband system to where they check you in at the de-embarkation hub here, and then from there they then scan you once we get to your next destination to show that an individual has arrived, but that band does not work in real time. And in terms of when, before you leave here, there is a triage to understand about the next destination. Most people will go to a general population shelter, wherever that could be. For individuals that need a little bit extra care based on their medical needs, they may go to a medical shelter. And for those that need the most care and has the highest acuity, hospitals would oftentimes be those next points of destination. Now, in terms of what some of the areas look like, now this is from last year. They update this about once every month to add new cities, new municipalities. So it's best to go to the STEER website to be able to see what's new and updated. And so these are just some of the ones from 2023 last year, but they have a couple more that have definitely been added this year of what it looks like in terms of those STEER counties that are participating. But like I said, there's about 110 at this point now out of the 254 counties here in Texas. And so, as we stated, no longer confidential. But at this point, actually, I think that we've gotten to, yeah. And so this is the website to go to register if you want to register online. It's one of the best and fastest ways to do so. So tdem.texas.gov/steer would be the way to do so. But then also, like I said before, if you would like to give us a call here at 201 and press option 4, we'll be able to register you over the phone as well. That interview process will probably take anywhere between about 15 to possibly 20 minutes, just because the STEER form is a little bit lengthy. It's about 6 pages or so of information, but it's still something that if you would like to do it online, it's, that is also a capability as well to do so online for the database at the STEER website. And so, yes, making sure to take care of yourself and as well as others, whether if you're in the response mode or if you are a person that's just living through the event. So just making sure that you're taking care of your emotional and mental health well-being. Some of the signs and symptoms of things to do on the left-hand side about knowing your physical reactions to stress, knowing what that looks like when it's a small amount or a large amount, and just being able to be mindful of how to be able to take action with either having good mental health hygiene and being able to practice your coping skills, whether it's in terms of reading, connecting with community members, making sure that you have your medication levels, that they're good to go, in terms of making sure that you're not just about out and that you have a couple of weeks supply possibly on hand, depending on your prescription. So that way, just in case if there ever is a situation to where you may have to leave your home, you're still able to then get your medication so you can still stay in compliance with your, whether it's your medical medications or mental health medications as well. And then also some things that you can possibly do is take a psychological first aid course to understand about how to deal with disaster-related stress and how to be able to help other people who are experiencing disaster-related stress as well as mental health first aid to understand the different types of mental health disorders, and then also about what that looks like in providing providing interventions for those people so that way everyone can maintain their safety as well as well-being. But that is all that I have for you all today in terms of how 211 interacts during those times of disasters. What questions do we have?
There aren't any in the chat. Miss Kenny, you have your hand up?
Yes, I do. I live down in the Clear Lake area of
Ms.
Houston.
Marla, you have a question?
Yes. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you loud and clear.
Okay. I live in the Clear Lake area of Houston. Mm-hmm. We have a problem down here, and we've experienced it with two hurricanes. We tune in to our local news, and they're usually, when there is an evacuation, this happened in Ike, they were starting in Galveston and telling people when they were supposed to be leaving and what route they were supposed to be taking, mm-hmm. and it stopped at Galveston County's line. Clear Lake is right next to it.
Right.
We had no time. It was that it was our time to get on the road. We were given no directions as to which way we were supposed to go. And I was wondering if you had any way to ensure us that we're going to get those instructions.
I can't speak from a city because that would be something in terms of like if you're getting it from your local municipality. Are you looking for in terms of instructions for like
I'm
evacuation?
About the local news.
Say
and I'm talking about the local news. What had this broadcast? I even contacted Office of Emergency Management after all the hoopla about Ike was over. Mm-hmm. And they said that they were going to get it corrected. Nothing has ever happened.
So from the 211 standpoint is what we do is we try to like find out the information of like the evacuation routes as well as times. One of the things that we heavily encourage is that if there is something coming, get out as early as you can. Do not wait to be told. Just because especially with what we're seeing with the rapid escalation to where it'll be a category or a tropical storm. But then we're seeing that once when it hits inside the Gulf, because of our warm temperatures that are abnormally warmer than it has been in the past 10 years, we're seeing that being so warm that there's that rapid escalation to where within maybe 18 hours or so, we're seeing tropical storms go to category twos, you know? And so being able to get out as early as possible also is where it's highly suggested to head to make sure that you head towards the west as best as you can. You know, a lot of times, sometimes people will say like they'll try and go north, which it depends on where you currently are. But like, especially if you're living on the coast, to try and head west as quickly as possible, because sometimes if you're heading north with this thing coming in from the south, it's chasing after you in terms of the path of the fall, you know. So being able to just get out as soon as you can, as soon as there is a relative projection for your area, I would not wait, and I would try and get out as quickly as possible.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Any other questions?
There's another question here in the chat. Thank you, Alex, for such a robust presentation of credible information. My question concerns preparing congregants for sheltering outside Houston and optimal
I think you cut out here. Let me check the chat really quickly.
I can just tell you,
county
Alex,
agencies
I'm sorry.
Like National Association of County and City Health Officials.
Thank you.
All right, let me see here. I missed a little bit of that. Let me check here in the chat here.
Alex, Pastor
yes.
Deb here. I'll just tell you. I'm sorry, I'm a little hoarse. I'm in a house full of German shepherds. I'm sheltered in Cyprus. Our meeting house was damaged badly in North Houston. I was just asking, we have congregants that are kind of spread out. We have mm-hmm. some in Magnolia and, you know, people spread out and vulnerable older people. Mm-hmm. People that have mental health concerns or recovery, that are in a real tight amount of regimentation or scheduling, when they get dispersed, we have a high amount of stress. So what do you recommend for churches? Are there any organizations? We work with the city, we work with the county, but NACHO is an organization of city county. And we're not a organization like that, so we don't belong to, or you know, professional trades. So what do you recommend for churches? Because I'm trying to build a resilience church group of leaders to take that to Department of Neighborhood. Thank you.
No, yes, there's a lot of organizations that have like a coalition of churches that are a part of disaster. So the first thing that comes to mind is, what is it? It's the one service out in Katy. I know that the individual's name. I have to look that up. But disaster, Katy Response. That's a part of a league of churches that come together, as well as Texas, Texans on Mission. They are an organization that's specifically for disaster response. So they do some preparedness work, but mostly in response to, you know, whether it's like, you know, cutting down trees, mass feeding centers, you know, being able to just be there, especially in the initial aftermath of situations, to help to provide those types of, you know, levels of assistance. I would also encourage to get involved with us here at your local emergency or your local local long-term recovery meetings and committees. So Montgomery County has one called Montgomery County Cares. Harris County has one, the Harris County Long-Term Recovery Committee, and also your regional VOAD. The regional VOAD covers the same 13 areas that we cover here, and it's called Gulf Coast VOAD. And so it's a combination of nonprofit agencies, churches, government entities all coming together, whether if it's in terms of planning to respond, or as we just did for both flooding, as well as the straight line winds, responding. And so there's a lot of like both religious institutions coming together, you know, nonprofit institutions coming together, and then government entities coming together. And we stay in communication all throughout the year in preparation for these types of events. So come and join us for the next VOAD meeting. So it's just Texas Gulf Coast VOAD is what you're going to be looking for on the internet. And we just stopped having our meetings for this last derecho event, but we always have our meetings in terms of regionally. So that way, and usually they switch it up and go to different counties as well, because we're 13 counties in terms of the coverage area for the Gulf Coast Regional VOAD. So getting involved with the VOAD, especially something I highly, highly, highly encourage. For
thank
any
you. I just found it. I just found it on the webpage. Thank you so much. And God keep and bless you in your work.
Thank you very much. Same to you. Any other questions, anyone?
I don't see anything else in the chat.
All right.
Go ahead and proceed with Amanda and Sapna with their presentation. Well, thank you very much, Alex, but I'm pretty sure there'll be something at the end. So kind of stick around. Okay. And we can see it.
Okay.
All right, Sapna, if that's okay. If you can hear me? Okay, good. All right, so hello again, everyone. Welcome to this portion of the presentation, Know Your Rights After a Disaster. I briefly want to tell you a little bit about Lone Star Legal Aid. We provide free legal assistance to low-income people living in 76 counties. And as Nia said in the beginning, the information we are presenting on today is just that information and should not be taken as legal advice. So let's get started with this presentation so you can be disaster ready and know what your rights are following a disaster. Okay, so I'm gonna start with the agenda. This is what we'll be talking about today. Blue skies, this is what we're calling the time before a disaster, when we should really be getting our affairs in order and preparing for the next disaster. And then I will explain the disaster recovery process, which is probably longer than you think it would be. Sapna will then go over landlord-tenant and avoiding fraud, and I will go over replacing documents and some FEMA basics. And Sapna will talk about insurance basics, and then I will give you a few takeaways and a few resources. So the next slide, let's talk about real property, personal property, and then just some general preparation. So for real property, this is your house and your land. So for flood insurance, Sapna is going to discuss this in a little more detail, but most people have homeowners insurance, but you don't realize you need flood insurance to cover flood damage caused from a natural disaster. So if you're watching this presentation, you should probably have flood insurance because you live in Southeast Texas. Another protection is homeowners insurance, which, like I said, most of you probably already have if you are a homeowner. And then besides insurance, there are things you can do around your home to protect it. You need to clear your drainage systems. Think about gutters, French drains at your own property. But you should also walk the streets. And those big gutters that you see in the middle of the street on the curb, they're almost always at the corner. Those need to be cleaned too. If there's a lot of dirt and muck piled on one side of the street, that's going to flow when the floodwaters are flowing. And so they're going to end up in the drains and it will flood your street and possibly your house. So if you're able to, you should check those out every now and then, especially if there is a storm coming. So secure anything that can fly around or damage your property. You probably had this happen with the recent storms that rolled through. Then some clear title issues, if you can. In order to get certain types of assistance after a flood, including FEMA assistance, you'll need to prove that you own the home. So it's good to work on getting the home into your name or getting something on file with the property records showing that you have an ownership interest in the property prior to the next disaster, so you're not delayed further after you apply for FEMA or other grants from other organizations. For personal property, these are your things, your furniture, jewelry, your car. Car insurance, Sapna will elaborate on this a little, so I'll leave that to her. You need to secure any loose property, make sure your homeowner's insurance covers contents, and then renter's insurance. If you're a renter, you need to get insurance to cover the contents of your apartment or home that you're renting, and you will need to get renter's flood insurance to cover contents that may be damaged in a flood. So finally, during blue skies, you should prepare, make a disaster kit, plan an escape route, gather shelter in place supplies, and scan and download important documents to the cloud and inventory your belongings. All right, so next up, the disaster recovery process. As you can see, the disaster recovery process starts immediately after a disaster and continues for years following. So the slide's a little small, so you may not can read these, and I don't want to read them all to you, but our focus immediately after the storm is usually issues like landlord-tenant, applying for FEMA assistance, because there is a deadline to apply, and getting your insurance claims in as soon as possible because of deadlines. And these fall into the 1 to 6 weeks category. And next, we start focusing on appealing FEMA decisions and denials. Again, there are deadline-related eviction issues in this time period. We're starting to see people getting notices to vacate and ultimately being sued to evict because they're unable to pay rent or they don't think they should have to because the place is damaged. Foreclosure issues because of unpaid mortgages, et cetera. And these are all in the 1 to 6 month time period. And some of these issues stem beyond that time period. This is just when we start seeing these issues. And then finally, 6 months to years later, we see people facing foreclosure and the possible need for a bankruptcy filing, still landlord-tenant issues, FEMA appeals, insurance problems, proving homeownership in order to get repair or rebuild assistance from community block grants. Yes, we're still seeing issues with this after Harvey, which was years ago. So now I'll turn it over to Sabina to talk about landlord-tenant.
Hi, everybody. So like Amanda said, I'm going to talk about landlord-tenant issues. And the question that we get the most is, you know, do I still have to pay rent? And can the landlord still charge me this much rent? And the answer to both of them is typically yes. Your lease is a contract. It's like any other contract that you sign, and you are bound to the terms of your lease, just like your landlord is bound to the terms of your lease, because you both sign a contract. So when there is a disaster, when there is damage to the property, your landlord doesn't have to let you out of the contract. You're still bound by the terms of that contract. If you're current on your rent, you can and you should request repairs from your landlord. Send your request by certified mail, return receipt requested, and make sure you're current on your rent. The way the Texas property code is written, a landlord does not have to make any repairs to your unit if you are behind on your rent. Let me say that again. A landlord does not have to make any repairs to your unit if you are behind on your rent. And you absolutely can never withhold your rent. Withholding rent in Texas is not a thing. Okay. If the property is completely uninhabitable, meaning under no circumstances can you live there, you can terminate your lease. You will send your landlord something by certified mail, return receipt requested. It's usually a form, you know, my name is Joe Smith. I live here. This is my apartment address. The apartment was damaged by the flood. You know, the roof is gone. You know, I'm terminating my lease, and you should be able to get your security deposit back. If the property is completely uninhabitable, unless your landlord is just completely off the wall, unreasonable, they're going to let you out of your lease because they know you can't live there. They will have submitted a claim to their insurance company. They're going to need to do repairs. They can't do any of that stuff if you're in the apartment. So they more than likely want you gone so they can repair the unit. If the home is only partly uninhabitable, and I say home, but this is, can be your apartment, it can be the home that you're renting, your rental property is uninhabitable, just partly, you can request a rent reduction. You request it in writing and you send it certified mail as well. If your landlord does not agree to reduce your rent, you have the right to file a lawsuit asking to have your rent reduced. The caveat here is your landlord does not have to agree to reduce the rent. The procedure is that the tenant actually has to file a lawsuit asking for the rent to be reduced. Again, most of the landlords are pretty, they'll work with you. You know, everybody, Houston does come together right after a disaster. Most landlords will work with you for just a little while. So we have seen landlords agree to reduce rent. We have seen landlords let people out of their leases. There are, of course, always a few bad actors that are going to make this really hard. Make sure your landlord has your current mailing address. You may not be getting important documents because your landlord is mailing them to your apartment. But if you're not living in your apartment or if you're not checking the mail regularly, then you're not going to be getting those notices. So just generally for evictions, a landlord has to give you a 3 days written notice to vacate before they file suit to evict you, unless another time is specified in the lease. Your lease can say, I only have to give you 1 day's notice. The standard is 3 days. Most leases say 3 days, but you need to check your lease to make sure it doesn't say 1 day. If you don't appear in court, you're going to get a default judgment against you, which means basically the landlord won. And you have 5 days, including the weekend, if you want to appeal. So 5 days in a row. Within 5 days, you have to either file an affidavit of an ability to pay costs, or you have to pay the appeal bond. The inability affidavit is a standard form, and most of the JPs, the justice courts where the eviction is held, will have that form available for you if you need it. If they don't have it, you can ask them for it, and the clerks are supposed to print it out and give it to you. It is on the internet. You can Google Texas Supreme Court affidavit of inability to afford costs. You file that within 5 days, or you pay the appeal bond. And if you're being evicted because you did not pay the rent, you also have to pay rent into the registry within 5 days. And then you have to pay rent as it is normally due. Now, unfortunately, what this can mean is that you will have two rental payments back to back. So, for example, if you lose on the 20th, your appeal is due on the 25th, and then rent is due on the 30th. Well, the first is the next day. Rent is due again on the first. So there are some situations where you might have to pay rent back to back. All right, avoiding fraud. This slide has mostly to do with repairs, repairs to anything, but typically when you're talking about a home. Do not agree to pay more than $1,000 or 10% of the job costs up front. Like initially, don't agree to give people any money. Don't sign completion papers or make a final payment before the job is done. I've heard way too many stories of people sending off that last payment and the contractor just skipping out, and then the person has to pay again to get the work finished. Never give anybody access to your bank account. Never, never, never. Never sign a contract on an electronic device iPad, tablet, or phone unless they've sent you a copy of the contract first. A lot of times when you sign it, that's common. People have an iPad or whatever, and you sign it, they should be able to send you that PDF before you sign it so that you can review it, you can read it, and then you can sign it. Never sign it until you have read it and reviewed it. Do not trust contractors who are going door to door following a disaster. Okay, this is very, very common. People will flood whatever state just had a disaster, and they will literally go door to door trying to get you to hire them to do repairs. Some of these people are great. Some of them know exactly what they're doing. They are contractors. Some of them are just fly by night people that are going to try to take your money and scam you. So if someone is coming door to door, they have to advise you orally and in writing that you have the right to cancel any kind of contract within 3 days. They also need to give you a contract or receipt stating the date of the deal, the name and the address, and the right and a statement that you have the right to cancel the contract and where you can mail the contract cancellation notice to. Contractors in Texas are supposed to be bonded. And so there is a website, which of course I can't remember right off the top of my head, but I'll find it and I'll send it to Nia, where you can check on your contractor, to see if they're licensed and bonded. If you're insured, get an estimate of the damage and repair costs from your adjuster. Beware of door-to-door sellers who give lowball estimates, who refuse to give you a copy of the contract or try to manipulate your emotions. Don't let anyone pressure you into signing a contract. Don't let anyone make you feel stressed or worried or feel like your house is going to fall down around you if you don't sign this contract right away. Anybody who is doing that is someone that you don't want to deal with. Do not give your FEMA benefits to anybody. FEMA awards go to your bank account directly, or they will send them to you by check. Hold on to that money and treat it like any other money that you use to repair your home. And then check to see if your work needs permits. A lot of work needs permits. When you get your roof repaired or fixed, the city requires a permit. Electrical work requires permits. Plumbing requires permits. Permits are the responsibility of the homeowner. So this is just a checklist, a to-do list. Don't trust contractors who are doing these kinds of things. Discounts referring other people to them. Now, this is different than give me a good recommendation on Yelp or give me a good recommendation on Google. This is the guy who says, I'll give you 5% off if you refer me to your neighbor. This should ring off some bells for you. Someone who requires an immediate decision, someone who asks for large payments up front, someone who only accepts cash. This one's a little trickier because more and more people are paying by Zelle, which is technically cash. But again, you're never going to want to pay anyone more than a small amount up front. You're never going to pay them all before they're finished. And structurally, any contractual work that you do should be worded so that you pay in phases. So you'll pay X amount of dollars on this day, and then you'll pay a little bit more, and then you'll pay a little bit more, and then you'll pay the final payment when the work is done. And if the work requires inspections, your contract should say, final payment is only done upon, the inspection passing. Like if you've messed up the work and I don't pass the inspection, I'm not going to finish paying you this. Don't trust someone who asks that you finance repairs through a lender that the contractor knows. You should investigate and sign with your own lender, not someone the contractor knows. Someone that provides written contracts that won't allow for verbal agreements or won't allow you to change the contract. Definitely don't sign with someone who won't give you a contract. Don't sign with someone who offers a lifetime warranty or guarantee. That is not a thing in construction. That is never a thing in construction. Everything wears down. Everything breaks down. Most products will have some sort of warranty, like a limited warranty, right? 10 years, 15 years. Workmanship typically is 1 to 2 years. Anyone who says, I'll come out for the rest of, the lifetime of the house, that's not someone that you want to work with. That is not a thing. Someone who's offering to use your house as a demonstration, as a reduced rate, also be wary of that. They don't have a local telephone number. You want to look at that. If they all of a sudden have unforeseen problems that need more work at a higher cost, you want to be wary about that. And you should have in your contract what that looks like. If when you're, you know, tearing down the walls, you find plumbing problems or you find X, how does that work out? Like, how do we negotiate that? That should be written into your contract. Don't let someone buy extra materials and sell them to you. The flip side of that is make sure you get what you paid for. If you're paying for pressure treated, termite treated, water treated, mold treated wood, make sure that's what you are getting. And again, anyone who is pressuring you into scare tactics or using intimidation.
All right. So replacing lost documents. This can be a pain after a disaster, right? Your home is damaged, you've lost so much, and now you don't even have your driver's license or ID, or your social security card was damaged, your debit and credit cards were destroyed or lost. So you want to get these replaced immediately, of course. So these next couple of slides give you information on how to replace these. We have phone numbers and websites listed here for each one of these: driver's license, social security card, a food stamps or EBT card, and your debit card. And then on the next slide, we have information for lost checks, credit cards, the major ones like Visa, MasterCard, American Express, and Discover, and then death, birth, and marriage certificates. So those information, that information is on those two slides. And so next.
I'm sorry. I just wanted to say also, a lot of people forget that when you open a bank account or if you're working, you will have given your employer or your bank a copy of your current driver's license. So if you have absolutely nothing, a lot of these places will require at least one piece of identification. Go to your bank, go to your employer and say, hey, I remember you took a copy of my driver's license. Do you still have it? I need it back so I can replace whatever it is I'm trying to replace.
Perfect. Good information. All right, let's talk about FEMA. So right after a disaster, this is the process of how FEMA comes about. The governor requests the disaster declaration. Then the president makes a federal disaster declaration. FEMA assistance becomes available and the application process opens up, and you will apply for assistance if you need it. FEMA will send out an inspector to inspect the damaged property. Then there's a FEMA decision and you'll have an appeal period. And then there's a possible recoupment period. So when all is said and done and you've received assistance, FEMA can come back and ask you for proof that you spent the money on what it was intended for, or that you didn't get a duplication of benefits, meaning that you got insurance proceeds that covered all of your loss, and then you also got FEMA assistance. So the application process, as soon apply as soon as you can after the disaster declaration. So you can do this online or on the FEMA app or your smartphone or by calling FEMA. And we have them listed here, the website disasterassistance.gov, or you can do it, download the mobile app, and telephone is 800-621-3362. Possibly the best way to apply is in person at a disaster recovery center or a DRC. You get to see a FEMA rep, and also there are other types of assistance available at DRCs. There's several open around the state right now as we speak. I think there are 7 in Harris County alone, and possibly more will be opened. So there's a 60-day deadline to apply. You only have 60 days to apply from the date of the disaster declaration. That's the one that's made by the president. And sometimes it's extended if the disaster is substantial, like Hurricane Harvey was. So the next slide, FEMA provides assistance for home repair, personal property, and for personal property replacement. So for real property, FEMA will help with repairs to the home that you own. They will not fix all of the damage. They will not cover repairs covered by other sources, like if you have insurance and it covers the entire loss. FEMA is not going to give you money for that as well. Once FEMA money is received, if it's for a flood, then you must obtain flood insurance. If you receive FEMA assistance at your property, you must maintain flood insurance on that property forever to be eligible for FEMA future FEMA assistance. This is subject to statutory caps. The amount changes yearly due to inflation, so there is a cap on the amount of FEMA assistance a person can receive. It is for each type, for real property, for housing assistance, and for personal property. The cap right now is $42,500. So you could get $42,500 for home repair and $42,500 for personal property or for the other needs assistance. That also includes transportation and other things. So if you are a renter, you must qualify for rental assistance if your apartment is uninhabitable, meaning FEMA will pay you to rent another place. You may qualify. I think I said must, meaning FEMA will pay you to rent another place or stay in a hotel while your apartment is being repaired. So for personal property, you used to be required to apply for a loan from the Small Business Administration or SBA to receive assistance for personal property and other needs from FEMA. But after the March 22nd update, you no longer have to apply for the SBA in order to open up other needs assistance. In Texas, this type of assistance is administered by the state through the Health and Human Services Commission, and it covers items lost or damaged in the flood, including your car. To qualify for assistance for your car repair or replacement, you must carry at least liability insurance. And they will not, the assistance will not replace all of your items. For instance, if you had a luxury rug or a flat screen TV, FEMA only replaces items they consider necessary to live. And it's also subject to the statutory cap. Like I said earlier, it's the same amount as home repair assistance. It's a separate pot of money. So there are two caps on home repair assistance and for other needs assistance. So other types of assistance that are possible after a disaster are funeral assistance. FEMA will cover the costs of funeral if you prove the death was a result of the disaster. There's unemployment assistance. You may qualify if you lived in a disaster area and lost your job because of it. And then there's disaster food stamps may become available after a disaster to people who experience a loss of income or have other disaster related expenses and meet certain income limits. And just to clarify, I'm talking about disaster SNAP or DSNAP and not replacement SNAP. For this most recent storm, replacement SNAP is available for people who receive regular SNAP benefits and their food was destroyed during storms. DSNAP, on the other hand, is not available at this current time. And for DSNAP, you must not have been getting regular SNAP food benefits at the time of the disaster. And they also have crisis counseling available. And then the next two are newly added for disasters that are declared after March 22nd of this year. So these are included in the disaster that just got declared. Serious needs assistance. This is money to pay for emergency supplies like water, food, first aid, infant formula, diapers, personal hygiene items, or fuel for transportation. It is available in all disasters declared for individual assistance. And the award amount is adjusted annually, and it does count toward the maximum cap that I mentioned earlier. Displacement assistance is money you can use to stay in a hotel or a motel, stay with family and friends, or for any other available housing options. And it also counts toward the maximum amount of the cap that you can receive. All right, so finally, on the next slide, I will talk about the appeals process before SAPNA gets into insurance. So check your application status. Review the method of communication you approved and make sure to check that source. So if you applied by phone, email, text, snail mail, make sure you know how you applied. If you applied and opted to receive things in the mail, then they're going to send it to you in the mail. If you have email in your email and their portal, if you register online and you want it to come to your portal, it will come to your portal. So review your FEMA letter. If you're happy with the decision, there's no need to appeal. If you're denied or you don't think you received the amount necessary to fix your property, then write an appeal to FEMA or reach out to us to possibly assist with doing an appeal on your behalf. Just remember that the amount provided by FEMA is to make the home habitable, not to make the home the same or better than it was prior to the disaster. And you have 60 days from the date of the decision letter to file an appeal with FEMA. Send in one single appeal for both your real property and your personal property. FEMA will send your personal property appeal to the state. Like I said before, personal property is handled by the state, but FEMA will forward the info to the state to review. So what to send in? Document everything: mold, mildew, flood damage. Send pictures. Submit your own estimates for repairs if you have them. Your own contractor's bid with estimates and with the contact information, because FEMA will call the contractor to confirm if needed. For cars, your mechanic must indicate that the damage was caused by the disaster and include contact information for the mechanic. And if FEMA did not pay you for work you already did, submit your receipts. This would be for like mold removal and cleanup immediately following the disaster. So FEMA sent me money. You must use the money in the way FEMA told you to use it. You do not get to substitute your judgment for FEMA's judgment. FEMA can request proof of how you use the money. And if you don't use the money for what you're supposed to, FEMA can try to recoup those funds. So now Sapna is going to discuss the wonders of insurance.
Okay, insurance. So homeowners insurance, I think, is what most people think about when they're thinking about insurance. So that's why I put typical insurance in here in quotes. You can buy homeowners insurance through any insurance company that will sell it to you. I say that will sell it to you because that's actually becoming harder and harder depending on where you live. Fortunately, in Texas, no insurance carrier has pulled out yet, but there are some flood-prone states where insurance companies are just leaving, saying they can no longer afford to provide insurance. There is typically a deductible for a named storm. You're gonna have to check your policy to see what that amount is. It's usually a percentage and not a dollar amount. So it'll be 2% of the damage or 5% of the damage, which can end up being thousands of dollars. That is your deductible. Dwelling coverage pays for damage to the structure of your home if the damage is because of a covered peril. So if you have homeowners insurance and this last round of storms that came through where a lot of the damage was caused by winds or trees, most homeowners insurance policies cover that kind of thing. And so you submit your claim to your home insurance company to come out and look at your roof. Personal property coverage pays for damage to your belongings if they're damaged by a cover risk. So if a pipe bursts in your house and your kitchen floods out, that is the kind of stuff that is typically covered. Renter's insurance only covers content of your apartment. The landlord is responsible for having insurance that will cover the actual building. So if you're a renter, the only kind of insurance you can get is contents. Flood insurance is not covered by a standard homeowner's insurance policy. Flooding happens in lots of ways. There's saturated ground, there's overflowing, surging bodies of water, ponds, lakes, and oceans. The easiest way to think about this, although it's not 100% clear cut, but is that floodwater is going to come from the ground up and stormwater is going to come from the roof down. So if the water starts on your feet and it starts going up, that is going to be floodwater. If the water comes in from your ceiling because it's coming in through your roof, that is going to be storm water. It's kind of, like I said, a pretty basic example of the difference in those two things, even though all of the water comes from the same storm. They are classified differently. You purchase flood insurance through the National Flood Insurance Program. If you live in a flood zone and you've already received FEMA assistance, you are required to get flood insurance. Flood insurance is not cheap. It actually has gotten more and more expensive. So this can actually be cost prohibitive, unfortunately. If you're a renter, you have to get renter's flood insurance. Again, flood insurance is different than regular insurance. So if you are a renter, you're going to have two kinds of insurance: renter's flood insurance and renter's contents insurance. Flood insurance is governed by federal law. And then I put on here the website where you can check out more information about flood insurance. Car insurance. Texas only requires liability insurance. That is all that you need. Liability insurance will not fix your car after a flood. If you're going to rely on your insurance to get your car fixed, you're going to have a comprehensive insurance policy on your car. If your car took on water, there's a really good chance your car is going to be totaled out. Now, if you do actually have liability insurance, you can apply for FEMA to help you repair your car. Your car would fall in under ONA. Depending on how much you get for your car, that might eat up a big chunk of your ONA allotment, but it can help you with that if you do actually have car insurance and your car was registered. It has to be a legal car in Texas. Okay, so generally the insurance process. File a claim with your insurance company as soon as you can. Your policy will tell you how long you have, but most require immediate notice. There is kind of a written in grace period. You know, they realize that if you've just survived a storm, you kind of need a little bit of time to get your wits about you, but file as soon as you can. Call, go online, use your app, however it is that you communicate with them. File a claim. You also have to file a claim with your flood insurance. They are two separate companies. Your homeowner's insurance is not going to send a claim over to your flood insurance company. Keep a copy of everything you give the insurance adjuster. Do what you can to mitigate your damages. So if you've got water coming into your house, you know, for example, if you've got water coming into your house because the valve under your sink is broken, you're going to turn off the water under your sink. It's the same kind of thing. Turn off water wherever you can if it's coming in from a specific place. Get a blue tarp if you can, or any kind of tarp. Muck and gut. If you have wet drywall and you've got mold, take out the drywall. Take out that insulation that has mold and mildew of it. Before you do anything, take as many pictures and videos of everything that you can from every angle. Document everything. Remember that water is going to recede and you need proof of how high the water line was. And keep receipts of items that you purchase. Mold is hazardous. I think everybody knows that. So if you've got anything that has mold on it, you're going to want to clear that out. Don't throw anything away. If your health is at risk, put it outside your residence, but have it available in case the inspector wants to look at it. Does that mean you have to have 5 rooms of drywall and 5 rooms of insulation piled up in a corner? No, right? But keep some of the drywall, keep some of the insulation, take a bunch of pictures. So if the inspector comes, you can say, look, here it is. I didn't keep all 5 rooms of it, but this is what was in my house. Do not clean your car. Don't use it. If you had water in your car, the inspector needs to see the grime line in your car to get an accurate picture of how high the water got. If your engine gets wet and you turn it on, that water in your engine will destroy your car. I have heard of people letting their cars completely dry out and then turn them on. It's not a dice I would roll, but I also understand sometimes you just need your car. Again, file your claim as soon as you can. Take pictures of everything. Flood insurance, again, you're going to report your loss immediately to your insurance agent and your carrier. You can ask them about advance payments. That is an option under flood insurance. You only have 60 days to file a proof of loss, and you have to use this form that is hyperlinked here. FEMA can extend the deadline, and they have in the past. If part of your claim is denied, you can ask for an additional inspection. You can get your own adjuster. You can submit evidence to the company. But all of this has to be done by the proof of loss deadline. So it is a very quick turnaround. 60 days is very, very quick. If you're dealing with a wide scale loss, I mean, it might take you 30 days before you can even get someone to come out and look at your house. You can appeal a flood insurance claim directly to FEMA. FEMA will work with you and your adjuster to gather the facts, look at the policy, and provide a decision. You have to appeal within 60 days as well. You've probably noticed that 60 days is kind of a running theme when you're dealing with FEMA. You can also get an appraisal for disputes for the amount of loss. But if you do an appraisal, you cannot also file an appeal with FEMA. So this is an either or situation. And you also have the right to file a lawsuit. And so this last hyperlink on here is the link to the FEMA's appeal process for flood insurance. This is just an infographic, so I'm just gonna go through this. It's everything that I kind of already talked about, but it's a handy one pager if you're dealing with flood insurance. Homeowners insurance, read your policy. Your policy will cover exactly what is and is not covered. Your insurance policy is also a contract. You are bound to the terms that you signed. If you don't like the estimate that comes back, if you feel like you've been underbid, you can ask for another inspection. Most companies allow for a second inspection. You can also pay for an independent adjuster to come out and evaluate. And if the independent adjuster rates your damage differently, you can send it into your insurance company as part of the appeal. Insurance companies are regulated by the Texas Department of Insurance, and you can file a complaint against your insurance company here. Again, this is a contract, and so basic contract law applies. If you and your insurance company are still not able to come to terms, you do have the right to sue them for breach of contract, but it's a pretty heavy burden because you have to prove that they were required to cover your loss. One thing that is just a trick of the trade, unfortunately a bad trick of the trade, insurance companies a lot of times will have in their policies that if your appliances were damaged because of an electricity surge, or anything electronic was covered because of an electricity surge, that they are not required to cover it. They don't tell you, but what they expect is that if the power goes off like it did May 16th, and like it did for me last week, you will walk around and unplug every single electrical appliance that you have so that when the power comes back on, if there is a surge, you don't burn out your appliances. So if you haven't turned things off, especially your air conditioning unit, actually turned it off or unplugged things and things burn out because of a surge, most of the time your insurance company is not going to pay for it. If you have windstorm insurance, you can file a complaint with the ombudsman, and this is the link. You have to meet certain requirements established by the legislature, which include the location, denial of coverage from at least one authorized insurer, and adherence to windstorm building codes and other requirements.
All right. So if you got lost at any time during all of that, on this slide, we have the takeaways. If you don't have insurance yet, consider purchasing it. Regular insurance will not cover floods. Renters need to get specific renter's insurance. File your insurance claim immediately. Take lots of pictures of everything and gather evidence of your damages to submit to your insurance inspector. Make your house and apartment as safe as you can. And then Sapna just gave that pro tip about if your power goes out, make sure you unplug everything because there could be a surge. And be aware of bad contractors. And then finally, on the next slide, we have some resources. There is the Legal Aid Disaster Resource Center. It's a great website with valuable information regarding all disasters. It will have the date of the FEMA appeal deadline, links to how to apply for unemployment, and DSNAP if it's available. And it has everything you need to know there. And then advocatesfordisasterjustice.org. This is more geared towards advocates for disaster survivors. However, it does have some good information under the FAQs tab, and it also has disaster preparedness information if you click the link to that on the banner on the main page. And then floodsmart.gov, this has info on the National Flood Insurance Program. And then the Office of Flood Insurance Advocate, it advocates for Advocates for the Fair Treatment of Policyholders and Property Owners, and has some good links regarding flood insurance. And then our last slide, I was just gonna show either, it's how to apply for our services at Lone Star Legal Aid, either online at lonestarlegal.org or by phone at 1-800-733-8394. And that is the end of our presentation. Thank you. And she has it back up, the information. Did we lose Nia?
Let's see here.
Can you guys hear me?
I'm trying to see in the chat.
My internet has been on the desktop and the laptop is completely keeps going out, so I had to log in on my phone. Are you guys waiting for questions? Because I didn't hear what was just said just now.
This meeting is being recorded.
Okay, now it comes back up. But I am not going to. I'm not even going to connect on the laptop. I'm just going to close that up because it keeps going out. But I did have a question for Alex. Alex, you still there?
Yes, I am.
Okay. My question was, you said that the registering for the steer is no longer like private or what have you, or it's never. So what should someone look out for, or should they be aware when they're given all this personal information? So, you know, especially now, you know, with disasters, all kinds of scams and fraud and all that kind of stuff comes out. What do you need to do to kind of put people at ease that steer is a reliable service, a reliable resource, and are there certain questions or information that would not be asked so that they'll know if this is a legitimate person that they're talking to?
So the only way that you could do it would be like by calling us here at 211 and then registering with us. So no one is calling you to register you for steer.
Okay.
Number one. But then also the reason why we really emphasize that it is no longer confidential is because it used to, many, many years ago, it used to be to where they wouldn't get like specific detailed information from you. But now it's shared amongst local law enforcement, federal law enforcement, federal agencies as well, to work with coordination, whether it's with state entities or partner agencies. And so it's just educating people about steer might not be the best thing for them to sign up for. It could be based on just different types of like statuses that they may have. So just educating the public about that it is shared amongst law enforcement, so that way they can make the best choice that works well for them.
Okay, I'm trying to make sure all of the links that have been talked about, I've been trying to kind of put them in the chat, but I wanted to let everybody know that I'm going to be emailing those links out. Sapna just put in the chat about the contractors as well. I'll be including that information when I send out the link of the recording of this session as well. So I didn't see any other questions in there in the chat, and I didn't get anything else that was emailed to me prior. Let me just double check here. I did have a question also did for Sapna too. When I heard you say something about that you can't do the FEMA appeal and something about disputing an appraisal or something like that.
So that's for flood insurance only. There is a separate process for appealing a FEMA award after a disaster versus if you're dealing with flood insurance, which is managed by the federal government.
Okay. And I know in some of our other, like in our home buyer education class, we generally have insurance representatives that come, and they always talk about, there's a website that you can go to kind of check the background of your insurance company before you go to apply for insurance or before you go to get insurance to make sure that they're financially stable, because there are a lot of, you know, kind of really small insurance companies that don't have the financial backing to even pay out for a disaster. They'll, you know, set up, close up shop and just kind of go away and not pay out any kind of claims. Is it like the Department of Insurance or something, Texas Department of Insurance or something like that, where they want to, if they want to check out insurance companies to make sure that they're reputable and still in good standing?
Texas Department of Insurance, and I put the link in the chat. That's a good website. Thank you for bringing that up. Yeah, that is a good website.
Boy, oh boy. See, I'm always told that whenever we have these kinds of issues, that it's the devil trying to keep us from getting all this information out to people. So we're going to get it one way or another, and I'm going to get it out to everybody. It keeps closing down on me. So let me hurry up and get to the chat real quick before. Okay, it is. And Alex just put in here what you need to know about disasters from United Way 211. And I will make sure that that gets in there as well. Okay, I think I have that. So, Rachel, was there anything else that you guys would that you'd like to add in regards to 311 or anything that the city of Houston's got going for disaster preparedness?
Yes. So what I would definitely recommend, because we partnered with the Office of Emergency Management, and we use the STEER program, and you know, we help them out with the STEER program, make sure that, you know, the information is accurate. And whenever you do, let's say move or something happens, point of contact, make sure you update that information, because when they do wellness checks to call or wellness checks door to door, the address is wrong, the email address may be wrong, the phone number may be outdated. So make sure that you keep up to date information about the person that's registered in the system. And then also make sure you tune in to your council member offices. They make sure that you're signed up to their newsletters, that you follow them on social media, because a lot of them assist with water distribution drives or food drives and things of that nature that you can take a part of, that they will put on for those that are affected in the districts that they serve.
Okay. I'm going back through, checking the chat, make sure I didn't skip over anybody's question. And also, let me check Facebook to see if anyone has any questions there. I don't believe, though. I do believe that's it for you guys. Is there any last minute anything that you guys would like to add or any other questions, Alex? Okay, yep, I did include that link already for STEER. I put that in there. If there are any other resources that you guys can think of that you'd like before the recording and things go out, just please feel free to send them to me, and I'll make sure that it gets submitted to everybody too. The information that Sapna was talking about as far as the eviction and the eviction process and things like that, Lone Star Legal Aid also does an eviction presentation for us the third Tuesday of each month. So if you want to come back and get the more details about the whole eviction process, if you find yourself facing eviction, especially now with disasters and storms and things like that coming up, and you want to know what your rights are in a little bit more detail as far as your tenancy and your landlord are concerned, you feel free to come back and join us for that as well. And I do believe that is all that we have. Thank you guys very much.
Thank you.
We appreciate you.
Thank you.
For providing this information to the community, for getting, oh no, there is a question here. Ms. Ernest says, I am venting. This is a sad, that it's sad about not receiving SNAP for people who lost their food in the storm. FEMA stated that our home was not damaged. You cannot receive any funds for food. Lights have been out for the last 2 weeks and still have no way to keep food and spending money out to eat. So what does somebody do in a situation like that?
So they should be applying and at a minimum should be eligible for the serious needs assistance with FEMA. If they have food stamps, they should be calling 211 and asking for replacement food stamps.
Okay. Contact 211.
So if the individual is currently on SNAP, that's 211 option 8 for getting the SNAP benefits replacement. If they do not have SNAP, they can call 211 option 1, and we can see about what food pantries close to where they are possibly providing those food related assistance.
But FEMA does have the serious needs assistance, which is one of the new categories, so it should cover food loss. It takes a while, they have to process everything, but they should be eligible for it.
Okay, I'm going to type this in the chat for her. serious needs assistance is what it was called.
Is what it's called through FEMA.
And this is a new assistance since March 22nd. So it could be that FEMA's denying people erroneously for that. I don't know. I think it does involve an inspection. So I don't know how they're inspecting power outage that was prior, unless you could send in proof that your power was out. This is new for all of us, this type of assistance. So.
Okay. And you said 211 option number 8.
That's correct. If they had SNAP before the disaster and they're looking to get that replacement benefits put back for funding, that would be currently 211 option 8 is what they've opened up specifically for this disaster.
Okay. All right, I put that in the chat for her on Facebook. Yeah. And hopefully this will help. All right, thank you guys very much again. We really appreciate it for all those that are watching. And I do apologize again for these technical issues that I'm having. I got 3 different screens up here trying to make sure I stay connected somehow with everybody here. So thank y'all for being patient with me this afternoon as well. So with that being said, again, the recording of this presentation will be sent out to everyone that has registered. It is also broadcast on the social media, on Facebook, on the AMOS page, and we've been sharing it on the other platforms as well. And the recording and the resources will be emailed out to everyone so that they can go back and view again and hopefully forward and pass along the information to other people that may find this information to be beneficial and you know themselves that are in need as well. So if there are any questions of anybody else, please feel free to reach out to myself or to Rachel, and we'll make sure that we try to forward your information or to whoever it is that that be able to assist you guys with whatever need that you may have. So thank y'all very much. We will relinquish the remainder of your time for this afternoon. Hope that everyone stays safe. Please prepare a plan. If you don't have a plan already, do what you need to do to get one in place. It is essential to make sure that you have at least your basic needs covered throughout this season and all seasons when it comes to any kind of a disaster or preparing for any kind of a devastation or a loss. So have a plan in place. It's better, like he was saying, to have one in place and not need it, and to need one and not have anything prepared. So thank y'all very much. Amanda, Sapna, Alex, thank you guys very much for taking the time out of your schedule this afternoon to provide this information to the community. We really do appreciate it. On behalf of all of our month of service partners, we thank you all for joining us this afternoon. Again, stay safe, take care of yourselves, and we will see you all next time. All right.
All right, thank you.